Alright, get this set up. Welcome to the yearly Haskell BOF. The starting slide is the same one as last year, but the numbers changed. But in contrast to last year, I'll try to keep the talk part short, so we can have more time for proper discussions. But I'll still say a few words. Quick overview about the Haskell team for those who are not already active in it. Then a few things that have changed recently during webcam or shortly before. Fancy new stuff. And then open discussion for various things. And I have a few bullet points of stuff that we could discuss, but of course there's room for more. So yeah, we are the Haskell group, so we maintain both the Haskell compiler, the Haskell libraries, which has both, a few Haskell programs as well. Historically, we were only doing libraries. We took over the compiler later, because actually maintaining the compiler and maintaining libraries is a fairly different thing to do, but we do it now, so that works. I like these numbers. It's the same, not the same numbers, the numbers are up to date, but the same script from last year. So this is packages in the archive per maintainer, and we are at, but of course the numbers are far too high. It's actually binary package version combinations across architecture that have ever existed. So that's maybe not the number we want to look at. So if we exclude the version from the list, we are far behind Debian kernel and package Perl, so they have more packages, but we update them more often, at least if you count the binary use. So the rebuilds on the buildsdb servers because of our API problems. And now we are in the third place of the archive, which is still good, but that's still cheating. It's binary packages, and if you've used our packages before, you know that there are three types of packages per source package. So the source package is maybe the right metric, and we are third place now. We surpassed Ruby extras. I guess that source packages that have ever existed. So we don't maintain 877 packages right now, so there might be some old ones that have been removed in the list. This is just SQL queries on Project B, the SQL database containing project information. And of course, Perl is far, far ahead. I once founded the Perl group. I don't mind them being first. That's okay. I can live with that. This is the number of uploads done by each group member in the last 6 months. And there's a slight, the numbers are not very healthy, I would say. So this is one thing for the discussion, how can you make sure that there's more people on top? We get bug reports about this stuff. More people on top and maybe, the number of people is good, it's just that the number of uploads is not very evenly distributed. And there are reasons for that, besides.
This is new package upload, right?
This is any package upload.
And it's wrong, because depending on when you did.
I ran it half an hour ago, so.
Because I have had 20 packages accepted.
Maybe it's. Is it maybe then not uploaded, but spinner made? Okay, you can have a look at that. I was also surprised.
It's just that I
think the tendency is still right.
Yeah.
Yeah, the tendency is still precise, right? So.
Okay. We seem to be very efficient compared to team size versus uploads. So we do lots of uploads per person, and that's partly that's owed to the benefits of packaging Haskell, because Haskell packages are very homogeneous. They are very consistent in what we get from upstream. They have good metadata. They usually build if the metadata is unfulfilled and the dependencies are fulfilled. So we can be packaging stuff very efficiently. Very little work per package. Otherwise, you couldn't maintain so many packages with so few people. Also, if it compiles, it works. So if I change something in the dependency and I rebuild it via Haskell's type system, as long as it's built, I'm fine. I don't have to test it. We do run the test suites, they are there occasionally, but otherwise I'm happy to upload an untested Haskell package to the archive, as long as it compiles. Then it's new, and that's of course a spelling mistake, so there are people now working on something like a distribution, but not on the distribution side of things, but rather on the Haskell side of things. It's called Stackage. It's run by FPComplete, a company investing in Haskell. And what they're doing is basically doing our job. So they are creating a curated set of packages, so a set of packages that are known to work together. So all dependencies are fulfilled and everything builds. And that's great, because that's what we've been doing, and they're doing it better. As in, they have better QA tools, better automation, they are quicker, and they are only focused on Haskell. So the plan that I came up with, that nobody complained so far, is that we will just build on their work. So for all the packages that are part of Stackage, which isn't all of them, unfortunately, we will simply take whatever is in the latest long-term release of Stackage, whereas long-term here means a few months, so it's not too long. And then for this way, for a large portion of our packages, we don't have to worry about is this package compatible with its dependencies in this version. So that's another time saver for us. The other points are the same as last year. Well, this is kind of a remedy for this negative point. Sometimes upstream doesn't give perfect metadata, and then we have build failures that we have to cope with, maybe we have to patch things. So for everything in Stackage, this is not a problem anymore, which is good. And for everything outside of Stackage, if it becomes a problem, we can kick it out. We can ask them to join Stackage so that it will not be a problem in the future, or we continue doing the manual patching and working around issues. And then the old problem of having to rebuild everything if you update a new version, but we seem to be coping, and neither the release team nor the vulnerability team has ripped off my head since we started doing this, so looks like Debian is coping as well. So for those that are new, hear a little bit about how we work. So basically, we try to always maintain this invariant per package. So we have a package plan, and I'll come to that on the next slide, which is basically a list of packages and versions, something that we believe is a consistent set of packages, and that's basically our to-do list, what we want to upload to the archive. Therefore, of course, everything has to be less than what's on package, but that can be quite ahead of what we have in our packaging repositories. That, of course, can be ahead of what's being tagged, because it's still being worked on, hasn't been uploaded yet, and that should always be ahead of what's in the archive. And this simple formula kind of guides our work. So if there's a new version of package we consider and we want to upload it to Debian, we first make sure that the package plan lists it and everything's fine. Then the next step would be to actually do the packaging, create the changelog entry, change control files, and we have a tool that tells us which packages need to do this step, and we have another tool that helps us with this step, and we have to build it, and when we upload it, we tag it, so that's this step, and that step should only be, there should only be an inequality here if the upload fails, because somebody messed up, Lintian rejects, or because it's new and it takes a while to go through new, so this should be an equality in most cases. You can interrupt me if you have questions. Don't mind that. Okay, package plan is a kind of neat thing that we have that probably not many other teams have. It's let me just make this a bit more readable. It's this file, packages, versions, and then maybe some annotations like don't run the test suite because for whatever reason don't want to run it. And then we have a tool which is this one that I ran here, which checks the package plan and tells us about things. So, for example, this package has been removed from the archive by now, and I should have also removed it here, so everything in capital letters is something to do, it's a mistake. But actually, everything capital is an error. Anything else is something to do. Like these are packages that we want to have in the archive, but we don't have in the archive yet, so we need to package them. And then it runs kabal install, which is the upstream package tool. comparable to cPAN or whatever you know. And we just ask it, can you install these 700 packages in these particular versions, fulfilling all the internal dependencies? And if it says, oh yeah, I could do that, so we're running this dry run, then we're happy. And if not, we get an error message and we have to do something. So this is a package plan. Turned out to be quite a useful tool. Right. We can add patches to upstream metadata if we have to. We can also add cabal files for packages that are not on Hackett, which is an exception, but happens in a very few cases. So it suits the needs. All right, next point on the agenda is a little update of what has happened recently. So until, I guess I could show that. This is the Debian URL checker, and right now 89.72% of all Debian packages that have a VCS darks field have a broken VCS darks field. Because we were basically the only one using darks for package maintaining, and now we switched to Git, so our darks repository has disappeared, and we haven't yet updated the VCS field in the control file. That's something we have to do soon. So now we're using Git. We do it slightly different than most of other people, so we have all packages in one repository. And I think it's a good thing. You don't have to worry about creating repositories and IDLs, setting up hooks, whatnot. And you can do commits that affect multiple packages at once. And sometimes, like, bumping the standards version in 700 packages. I don't want to see 700 commits for that. I'll stop here. I can explain the choices even more. Let's defer this discussion if there's discussion about that. I'll only know that it's a Debian-only repository layout, so there's no upstream sources in it. There are better tools, I believe, to get upstream sources into your directory if you need to. So this has been done. People have convinced me to do it. And slowly, the tooling also catches up. So yeah, we're adding more tooling to work with the Git repositories. Another new thing that I've been proposing and that we are slowly following is the concept of key packages. So previously, what happened was, say, a new version of GitNX pulls in random foo diagnostic, somewhat obscure package. And then the next version drops the dependency again. But then by then, we already have it in Debian. Should we just keep it in Debian? Probably not, because the only reason it was in Debian in the first place was for the dependency of a certain broken that we want to have in Debian. And unless there are other good reasons to keep it, maybe we should just remove it again. Similar like you would remove dependencies of your on your machine of packages that don't depend on it anymore. So get auto-remove. So we don't want to accumulate cruft. So the idea is that we mark packages that we want to have in Debian on their own right as key packages, and we can do this marking in the package plan. This is, for example, for whatever reason, a key package. And then we can use the package plan to find out, well, what packages do we have in Debian that are neither key packages nor dependencies of key packages. And I can look at them and say, oh, well, yeah, let's just get rid of it. Let's just not grow the package size too much for no good reason. So that we don't have to mark 100 packages as key, packages that are part of stackage are excluded from the removal. So they are all, basically, everything on stackage is considered to be a key package, not because it's important, but rather because it's simple. So everything on stackage is causing no work for us, or very little. So let's just keep them in. It's a sign that the upstream is somewhat active, and yeah, that's okay. During DevCamp, we created, packaged, documented, collected, assembled our tools a little bit better. Previously, there were scripts running, lying in random repositories. Now we have a proper package. See the next slide about that. Before DevCamp, I backported Cabal and GHC itself, 7.8, to Jesse. So in that sense, stable Debian release is a bit more useful for Debian development. You won't get libraries from Debian at the moment yet, but you can at least get your compiler and Cabal and Cabal install whatever you want with a not 4-year-old compiler. Then we have the latest compiler, which has been released only since a few months, so were still quite good for Debian standards in experimental. And we have started packaging, like updating on the packaging as required to support GCC 7.10 and the corresponding stackage release, which is stacked LTS 3.0. We did that on a, we're doing it on a branch of the package plan, the package repository, and we are basically making good progress. So there's a dozen packages that need to be looking at, and looking at can just mean we're going to be removing it. And I'm also waiting for coordination with the Pandoc maintainer so that we can test Pandoc's reverse dependencies, but it's only a few packages. So I guess we can maybe actually just upload everything to experimental by the end of the week. Might be a good goal. Then we have something to work on until then. Why to experimental first? There are a few new packages, and some of them are in the dependency tree, so if we do it to unstable right now, we would have large number of packages in unstable, uninstallable, until the new processing has happened. So if you upload the experimental first, and wait till FTP master have approved all the Haskell packages that are new, then we can then again rebuild everything for unstable, and upload GCC 7.10 and all 700 packages in one go to unstable, and have a very short time of Haskell being broken and unstable this time. I've been saying that this for every tradition, and it always caused something went wrong and it was broken for at least parts of it for a while, but at least you can try. Chris has worked on documentation, which is a very good thing. So the wiki page is now has a very useful page, which is highlighted, marked in bold, getting started, which gives you the steps you have to do for creating a new package, upgrading a package, planning for a new package, these kind of things. I'm constantly making change to the page because we are developing our tools. So this is a perfect way to go to the next slide. You can run upgrade install package Haskell tools, and you get a command dht, Debian Haskell tools, which has subcommands, because subcommands are the way to do it this century. And here's a list. We can just briefly go through it. Okay, Kabal Debian is a tool that's actually being developed outside of Debian. It's by David Fox, who in his company uses Debian and Haskell extensively. So he created a tool to create quite nice Debian packages from Kabal descriptions. And he's collaborating with us to make the output suitable for the official archive. And we've made more progress there. So in some cases, you can actually take the output as is without further testing. Mostly it depends on whether upstream has put the copyright field in the right place. If not, you just have to modify copyright and control, and at least the dependencies are being generated correctly in most cases, which has been the main difficulty in upgrading packages. So this is a wrapper around it, which looks at the Debianization that is there and finds out whether we run the test suite or not, what flags we pass or not, so that in even more cases you will get the correct output if you upgrade it correctly, directly. You still have to manually check it. For example, if flags depend on whether on the architecture, if testing depends on the architecture, these things are not mapped that easily, so the output would still be not quite right. Debian.dst is actually a general purpose tool which you point to a Debian directory, it'll fetch the upstream tarball and create a Debian sys directory without even unpacking the upstream tarball. So nothing really you have to use directly in this context, but maybe it's nice to have if you need something like this. DHT init creates an initial packaging using Kabal Debian, and it looks into the packages plan to find out what version number you want. So basically the package plan says this is alright, you just say Kabal init, DHT init foo, and then you will get the packaging for package foo. Actually Haskell.foo. So you give it the Kabal name and it'll produce a Debian package. Make all is actually not a script, it's a proper program because it's written in Haskell, so that's the difference between a script and a program, I guess. It rebuilds all packages from the packaging repository in a subdirectory, making sure that only build packages are being used and not what's in the archive. So you get a clean test of all packages. Takes maybe, I haven't, I still don't have a good number, but I think it's somewhere between 6 and 8 or 10 hours to build everything. We can maybe speed it up a bit. And that's basically what I want to use to make sure that transitions like GFC 710 are properly tested locally before we can upload. It's also something you can use to get dependencies installed, or at least built on your machine, that are broken in the archive because I haven't rebuilt them, or because it's stuck in you, or whatever. So you're no longer stuck waiting for that to continue other packages, as it was the case before. It doesn't take much space. It's less than a gigabyte, all the build packages. So it just takes time, and you can leave it running, and it'll notice changes and only rebuild what has changed. So if you keep the directory up to date, it might actually be a convenient way of building packages. Mass change is a handy script if you have to apply a change to many or all packages. You give it a description of the change, you give it a shell script on the line, which is usually running Perl or SED on certain files, and then the list of directories you want to apply the change to, and it goes to the directory, makes sure that the git state is clean, applies the change, sees if they actually changed something. So if the command is idempotent, you can just run it again, it doesn't matter. And if there's a change, it creates a changelog entry and commits to the repository. Tag creates a tag according to our tagging convention. Nothing fancy about that. Upgrade is similar to init. It uses Cabal Debian. It uses the package plan to find out what version you want to upgrade to. It uses Cabal init to update the dependency. So you get the new dependency specification and the build depends. And it does some fancy thing with Git. So it
you need that napkin that we drew it on.
Yeah, we had a napkin drawing. So it creates an empty branch that's unconnected to the rest, runs Cabal Debian on your old version, which might override some of your manual changes to, for example, changelog or dependencies at least. Then it updates to the new version, runs Cabal Debian again, and takes that commit and cherry picks it on top of your changes so that hopefully we have less manual work to do if there are some changes to the dependencies that are not being kept up with Cabal again. Still, it might be a merge conflict in some cases, and you should still check the diff afterwards. Upload is just a convenient script to upload, tag, and push. So you pass it a changes file, it'll sign the changes file, it'll sign it in a temporary directory, so to not interfere with the make-all script, which would otherwise maybe rebuild the package if you sign the source file, the DSC file, and then uploads it and tags it correctly. And the last two are basically scripts to tell you where this inequality is something to do. You have what to build, looks at the packaging repository for any packages that have a changelog entry that is marked for unstable or experimental, so it's marked to be that it's ready to be uploaded, but there's no tag. So usually if somebody who's not a DD, like Sven, pushes a change to the repository, I can run this script and figure out, oh yeah, something new to do for me, and I build it, and then I upload it. What to upgrade compares the packaging repository with the package plan, and finds anything that's where this one is not an equality. And this is these are the packages that I would then run upgrade on. And that's it. You can add more scripts to the tool and to the package if you want, of course.
So is the package plan test script part of this?
Yeah, right now the package plan and the repository are mostly separate. So the package plan has its own, you have the packages by the heel, and you also have the test packages script directly here. I guess that could also be changed. Since it doesn't really, I don't really care about it. There's no good reason to have it separate, there's no good reason to have it not separate, so you could probably do it. Yeah, people probably should, because it makes it rather main page. But these things have main pages now.
There is one complication, which is that the test package script maintains some state inside its own world, which is one of them is it copies your current installation, GHC installations, package versions out. So you can actually only run it for the system the same. You know, you can't run it on an unstable for 7.10. Even if you switch the branch,
but
it doesn't work.
But that's also true for some of these tools,
yeah.
Like Kabbalarium. If you're targeting GHC 7.10, you would run these scripts, or at least some of them, and you probably need to know the scripts well to know which one, in an S-change route that has 7.10 installed, because they query the current compiler for information about versions of the bundle dependencies.
So I mean, so there's, it's not just a script, right? It also has state.
Yeah. Okay.
I'll try to reduce the amount of state it has.
So I guess I was still talking more than I wanted to, but okay, we are at the discussion. So some open questions that I think, something that's still open from last year is, do we have a good policy on what we want to package in Debian and what not? Currently, the situation is we package whatever we, as maintainers, individually think, oh, this is nice to have, and then we do it. And then we just keep it there until the end of time, or until it's causing problems. Then there has been a discussion on dynamic linking, whether we should support it or not, how we support it, and what should we have different package names, or just use a system of provides and depends. Is there actually a benefit in dynamic linking? Does it outweigh the cost of dynamic linking? I guess it's a good discussion to have. And then, of course, can we change our workload so that it's spread more even? And for those who are new and want to contribute, here's some things that we can do independent of just updating packages. So this is the end of my prepared part, so I'll happily start now having the boffy title of the boff. Thank you.
So the question of what should we package? I really like the idea of the Stackage LTS stuff. I think that's very good. But there's still the question of what do we, the Package Haskell group, package versus how do we deal with stuff that people who aren't in the Haskell group have packaged that's built out of Haskell. So Pandoc is a really good example here. We have things that depend on packages that Pandoc produces, but Pandoc is not packaged by us. So we have an external dependency.
It's annoying.
It's really annoying. You know, I can understand Yunus's desire to not necessarily be subsumed into package Haskell. But by the same token, therefore, one really good question is, should we package anything that build depends outside of our set? Or should that be handled separately?
I don't know if we actually get to ask this question, because Pandoc is there, Pandoc is maintained by Jonas, and we have packages that will depend on Pandoc. And I think we want to have these packages. So I'm not sure if we can actually...
I just almost feel like there perhaps needs to be a separate set, so that we have, because at the moment we've got a set of packages that consist of a strongly connected, as it were, set of things that we can reliably maintain and manage as a group, and some other stuff that we can possibly reliably maintain and manage as a group, providing their external dependencies don't get in the way.
Not that technically Pandoc is maintained by the group, it's just not part of the technical process. Technical aspect. So if there's a problem in Pandoc, you are therefore allowed to fix it.
Right.
It's just that it's a bit separate because Jonas is taking care of it, and it's also used by lots of non-Haskell developers, so like user support or something, but it's good that there's a proper maintainer to have it. It's just an annoyance in our workflow. Okay, yeah, but that doesn't answer the question.
Is it the only package?
It's the only package.
In that sense.
Yes. Right. Yeah. There's only one other Haskell library package otherwise, it's Acta, which comes to the Haskell library, but it doesn't have any reverse dependencies. And actually, Ian told me that I'm happy to move Acta into our packaging repository if I want to.
Right.
Okay, here, a few people here actually, I don't know. We've talked that at lunch, so you're new and you want to contribute, that's great. So what about you three?
Well, I haven't packaged anything with Haskell. Interested in Haskell, but yeah, I haven't any kind of plans. Mostly I'm interested in. So maybe in the future, but not in the future.
Okay.
I have a few packages that I haven't been treating well lately, and first have to get a good foundation before I go to things that.
Alright. What about you? What makes you come here?
Well, so of course the basic assumptions. I also have a general interest in Haskell.
Okay.
But I did try to package something at some point, and I remember there was two different wiki entries which helped you use a Cabal and transform a Cabal to a Haskell package, I managed to do something which was enough to use it to put it on the server, because that was my original idea. I wanted to put something on the server and I couldn't compile it on the server, so I need to compile it somewhere else. And for that it was enough, but it wasn't anything that could have been uploaded to Debian, and that's why I wanted to look into it better, and I thought it was a good opportunity to maybe try it now and try it.
Great.
I'm just a Haskell user who invited yesterday.
Right.
So just looking around and seeing what things are.
So as a user, what, if anything, do you think we could do to the packaging of Haskell and Debian to make your life better?
Certainly does. So it makes GHC at least very accessible. Quite some languages too. So
is there anything that you want that we don't have?
I can't there because it's so easy to install them when I come out that I just skip over and forget about that stuff.
Mm-hmm. And a script that I think would be nice for someone to write would be one that double checks the co-installability of the content of the archive. Because in Jesse we've had a mistake.
So
the mistake in Jesse was manifested by the SHA-1 problem that I saw earlier this week.
Oh, because of Cabal. No.
We had two packages that were independent and built against different instances, I think, of SHA-1 or binary or something.
Binary.
And because we did a last minute fix that sorted something out with binary. Having a script that we can run against the archive to ensure that we're not getting into a situation where we need multiple versions of things installed simultaneously would be helpful, because to hit that problem again.
Yeah.
Do it once, oops, mistake. Do it more than once.
I'm not sure if that's actually possible, because I think the situations that lead to that are that you have a package that has a very odd dependency, like requires a new version of something that comes with THC, and you're making an exception to the rule that there's only one version per package. And then that's a logical consequence. Otherwise, you would have to rebuild everything with the packaged version of binary, and even that wouldn't help because binary is a THC bundled library. It comes with a THC package, and it's not upgradable easily. Like that's at least the assumption.
Right.
So it's
at least to be able to know what the limits are.
Yeah,
would be nice.
7 minutes. Okay. But thanks.
We should just try and think of extra possible tools.
Yeah, yeah.
That would be useful.
I guess we should start. So let's maybe come back to dynamic linking, because that's somewhat controversial and involves work. So for those who are not aware of it, currently every Haskell binary in Debian is statically linked. So all the Haskell code is being linked into it. It's one big blob, maybe a few dozens megabytes in size, but it doesn't have any dependencies into the Haskell world anymore. So all the build dependency or the dependency problems that we manage on the for library packages, we don't have to do that for the binary packages. So even if something broken during the transition, people can still install a pandoc. That's the current state of the status quo. What we could also do is we could link them dynamically. GHG supports that by now. And if we have the dynamic libraries already in the dev package, you would then probably move them to a separate package that only contains the SO file, the dynamic library. And the question is, what are the benefits, what are the disadvantages? So the benefits that people want to have from it are smaller binary sizes, because stuff is in the libraries, and if they have multiple different Haskell programs running at the same time, they save memory. Less RAM. Then another plus that people, let me just complete the list and then you can see if I missed anything. Another plus is that it's easier to specify data dependencies. For example, it's a good example. I think, let's say, pandoc sideproc may ship some data files that requires a runtime. So right now we have to jump through some hoops to make sure that every program that links this library inherits the correct dependencies onto the data package from the library. If it's a dynamic library, you can have the dependencies directly on the dynamic library and everything's easy. Then security updates are always a plus. You can rebuild the library, and every binary package using it is either broken or gets the security update. Then the downsides are that the size of the packages list would increase for every Debian user, and I've heard people complain about, I want 3 packages already. Having 4 packages per source package might make them complain more. Then we have breakage and unstable for programs. Unless you have 2 packages for each program, one dynamically linked, one statically linked. Also maybe not the nicest thing. Now this is basically cosmetics. Installing a package will now pull in lots of packages with weird names, and people might be put off by that, users. So currently we are hiding that, in a way. Anything else? Yes?
We might get upload amplification in the sense that if we update a library package, we may have to update a whole bunch of program packages as a result.
So,
that's actually another trade-off. Because the other choice you have, when you split the package into the package holding the SO and the package that has the master SO file system, is that you can actually, instead of just provide the package with a version number, can actually generate the package with a version number. Now, that has the great advantage for stable, once you're not updating very often, is that programs that were linked against an old version of the library will still be there and will be fine. But of course, it has the disadvantage in a rapidly developing situation that you accumulate dots and dots and dots of these libraries.
And more importantly, every single upload goes through you.
And you can't use the built views and the new features to rebuild stuff anymore.
Yes. So that's another that's a trade-off.
So currently, what I'm maybe not people many people know this, but I regularly look at this the output of the script, which tells me what Haskell packages need to be rebuilt on the archive, and I schedule them using Bonobuild. I have special access to that, and that's a very cheap way of rebuilding stuff compared to doing a sourceful upload. And I would veto anything that has less automation than this. So changing packages names. Unless we can do it with BinMU, which is not supported at the moment, seems to be out of reach for us.
Yeah, because in that case, what will happen is that you get lots of packages that get, they can be automatically generated, right? But they get submitted to new.
No, but it's not a policing client source packet that makes up package names. You have the package name into Debian control, so you're actually manually changing the control file to change the package name. You can automate that, but it's still a source for upload. And you have to.
I mean, the Java people do this for jars.
It's a matter of frequency, I guess. I mean, the C people do it, but I wouldn't want to do it.
So, what is Haskell specific on these plus and minuses?
It's just that
we that Haskell is a more rapid changing, and that it's historic. We only offer the one way.
And it's more rapidly changing, and it's changing in such a fragile, because every minor version upload requires an equivalent to an SO name bump.
That there are no ABIs.
There are ABIs.
But they're changing.
ABIs.
They're not stable ABIs.
Precisely,
that's the problem. Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
Another plus is that you can link a non-Haskell SO to a Haskell SO, but you can't link a non-Haskell SO to Haskell .a.
So you can have a Haskell shared object that exported signals to other libraries?
Yes.
Can you do that?
Yes.
Ooh.
And today you could depend on a dev package and use the SO that comes with all dependencies of this library is statically linked into it.
You can't statically link it into an SO because you're not using PIC.
So I didn't hear you.
Can you speak up?
So our Haskell libraries are not position independent code, so you can't link them into an SO.
So the .a's aren't built back.
Right. And you probably don't want them to be.
So at the moment we're providing SOs that we're not using?
Well, we're using them because GHG requires them if you load something with GHGI for Haskell. So GHG is using them internally.
Right.
But we're not using them in the distribution sense of shared libraries. We still need them to be there. Okay, I think we're running out of official time. Is there anything in this room afterwards?
I don't think so.
But the video team wants people to leave, right?
I know.
I mean, we could just all go to...
anyone else, but I'm hungry.
Oh yeah, we could just continue the BOF as a dinner BOF. So go to dinner together, at least those who are not scared by now. And see what comes out of it. I guess again, I talked too much, so we couldn't really get much discussion going.
But Clint, think you have more secret society things?
I think I have a few.
Okay, then I'll officially call this end, and thank you all for attending.